this week's Top Gear, can Saab's new 9.5 get to the beach before the Germans? The great three-wheeler renaissance, would you pay $7,000 for a bubble car? And how to run an extremely expensive motor for next to nothing.
Hello and welcome to the Saab 900, which is a large car. And then there's the Saab 9000, which is also a large car. So quite the last thing I was expecting them to do was to fill the tiny, tiny gap between them with another large car. But that's exactly what they've done. This four-door saloon is called the 9.5, and we have to assume it's better than the other large Saabs because it's newer. We also have to assume that people, no matter what it's like, will buy it.
And that hurts my head. I mean, if someone's going to buy one of these, just think what they're turning down.
The obvious choice for anyone with 22 to 25,000 to blow on a car is the 5 Series BMW. It's excellent in every way. Or they could have a Mercedes E-Class, which is excellent and robust. Then there's the Audi A6, a boss suit on wheels, but some people are going to turn down this car so they can have one of these.
So, what on earth do they see in it?
I really don't think it's got anything to do with the styling. Buying this instead of a 5 Series BMW is like turning down Cindy Crawford for a date with a Labrador. Now, people say it's very obviously a Saab, and indeed it is. But when you see a Labrador, you don't look and go, "Ooh, Cindy Crawford." So maybe it's a price thing then. Well, you can have one of these 9.5s for £22,000, making it cheaper than the opposition. But the gap isn't big enough to be convincing. OK, but Saab is forever telling us they make jet fighters and that this somehow rubs off on the cars. Yes, but Saab also makes buses and trucks. So, does that rub off on the cars too?
No, not really. A Saab is nothing like a jet fighter. Or a bus. A Saab is like a Saab. The ignition key, for instance, is down here, which is fine, except you have to put the gearbox in reverse before you can take the key out. Now, do you remember it's in reverse every time you start the car? And no. What else? Well, it's very big inside, and it's ideal for those who suffer from SBS, sweaty body syndrome. You see, next year you'll be able to order it with ventilated seats that come with internal cooling fans. But there's lots of nice touches right now. Look at this. A drinks holder that could have come from the hand of Brunel himself. And then there's the speedo. Big gaps lower down the range that get narrower once you go above 90. Not that you'll be doing that a lot. Oh, come on! Come on! For heaven's sake!
Now, you can have the 9.5 with a turbo V6 engine, but this model, I suspect, will be more popular. The bottom of the range, 2 litre. It's also turbocharged, but not like you might be expecting. Old Saabs had turbos like hobnail boots. Put your foot down and there was a week of nothing before the world exploded.
The old Saab turbo could get you from 40 to 70 faster than a Ferrari Testarossa. But this one can't.
It has a light pressure turbo, which is more like a ballet shoe. It's discreet and gentle, concentrating more on low-down grunt. But the downside is that it's no longer fast. 0 to 60 takes more than 10 seconds.
And nor is it especially refined. For this kind of money, BMW will give you a 6-cylinder engine that's smoother than Angus Deaton in a pair of trousers by Mazzola.
But the engine in this car is somewhere between Ian Hislop and Danny Baker. That said, the 9.5 has a very good ride. Compliant like the doorman at a five-star hotel, softer than the softest cheese. Amazing when you remember it shares a basic chassis with a Vauxhall Vectra.
But because they've based the suspension on Brie rather than cheddar, the handling is nothing to write home about. And I don't like the gearbox. And the driving position is pretty wrong. Oh dear.
So, he asked pointlessly, is it better than the competition?
No. Now, don't get me wrong, this is by no means a bad car. It just isn't quite as good as that infernal BMW.
Which brings me back to the original question. Why on earth would anyone buy it?
I think there are two reasons. First, unlike any of its principal competition, it isn't German. And second, it has headlights so powerful they could cast shadows on the moon. The Saab, therefore, is for people who don't see terribly well at night. People who don't like carrots. Me, I love them. Can't get enough of them. I worship at the altar of carrotdom. Mmm, delicious. Oh. I get dazzled by starlight.
If I were a rich man, yabba dibba 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 dum. All day long I biddy biddy bum. If I were a rich.
Just look at this lot. Pure, shameless excess. Lottery winner territory. Nice cars, mind, but they are big bucks. Add them up and you're looking at well over £160,000 of heavy metal. Just think of all that cringeworthy depreciation.
But what if I said there wasn't going to be any depreciation? That you could cheerfully run any one of these cars and it would cost you less to own than a hamster? You would say, he's completely off his face. Well, I'm not. Come on down and play the premium game.
I've got the brains, you've got the looks. Let's make lots of money.
If you'd been far-sighted enough to order any of these cars when they were announced, once you'd taken delivery, you'd be looking at drawing a thumping premium profit. How much? Loads. If you'd managed to buy a Mercedes SLK 230 at a list price of 34 grand, you could now sell it for 40,000, making a nice little earner of £6,000. Likewise, a CLK 320. List price is 42 grand, but you could sell it the following day for 55. And if you'd managed to jump the queue on a 355, you'd pay 100 grand. But you could sell it on for 105. Good day's work at 5 grand profit. You could even clear 4 grand on a Porsche Boxster. List is 40, but the market's paying 44. A couple of months ago, they were even paying 50.
So you ask, what is this weird phenomenon that is pushing the prices of cars up rather than down? Well, it's simple. Because there is a queue for hot, new, desirable metal longer than an NHS waiting list for a hip operation. We are talking 2 years for an SLK, 3 years for a CLK, 18 months for a Ferrari 355, and 6 months for a Porsche Boxster. All of which means that if you already happen to have one of these cars sitting in your garage, you will be in a rather agreeable situation.
But drawing your profit depends entirely on when you sell.
If you're travelling in Knightsbridge or in a city, and the timing of these things, you might see one SLK and go, oh, there's that new model Merc. You don't see too many of them. In 12 months' time, you go, oh, there's that new model Merc. Oh, there's another one. And it then becomes, well, why do I want to pay 10,000? I've seen, I want to be the man driving the car. I'll pay the price to have that benefit.
But it's not quite as easy as it sounds.
There's no guarantees in life and nothing lasts forever. My business is very much like the stock market. we carry between £1 million, £1.5 million to £2 million of the stock, and it can have £100,000 swing in a week.
Remember the Jaguar XJ220? Well, people queued to pay £415,000. But when they took delivery, it was only worth £150,000. So as long as you don't pay a premium in the first place, get a good spec and sell fast, you should be on to a nice old Eric and Ern.
We're in the money. We're in the money.
Put it this way, if you make a car as agonisingly pretty as the Ferrari 355, a car that makes you want to bite the back of your hand whenever you see it, then you tell people they can't have it for 2 years, then buying one is going to be a lot like playing tiddlywinks in a rugby scrum. Naturally, the manufacturers are none too happy about all this, and Mercedes in particular will wallop dealers very hard if they know they're selling to speculators. But it is essentially a free market, and if someone wants to pay all the money for the latest rinky-tink roadster, then so be it. And don't forget, of course, this is nothing new. It's been going on for years. Because there's been a waiting list for Morgans since the Ice Age, and new ones have always changed hands at overlist. So if you want your motoring to be free, come on down and have a bit of a flutter.
It's been a long time coming, and now it's finally here. This is the new Ducati. It's called the ST2, and like the band from Burnage, the boys from Bologna have decided to stick to what they know best. So Ducati's equivalent of drums, bass and loud guitars is a superb steel trellis chassis, sumptuous suspension and brakes, and a thumping great V-twin engine. It's a formula, but it's a winning formula. And at 9,250, it adds up to a top sports tourer. Hang on a minute. Ducati have built a sports tourer? That's like saying that Prince Nassim collects stamps, that Ferrari have built an estate, a diesel estate. But I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, what on earth is he on about? What is a sports tourer? Well, there are full-on fast and frantic sports bikes, there are laid-back lard bucket tourers, and there are sports tourers, somewhere in between. Got that? Good. Stand by me. Nobody. So, this is a different Ducati. Most Dukes offer a supercharged shot of adrenaline for those who can put up with a cramped accommodation. But the ST2 is an altogether more relaxed ride, with high bars, low pegs, a well-padded seat and a substantial screen. Panniers on a Ducati are like PVC pants on the Archbishop of Canterbury, but here, they don't look too bad. Basically, it's about getting the recipe right. And just like the one for Mama's special sauce, the boys from Bologna have got this one absolutely bob on. What you do is take 944 cc's of prime Italian V-twin. You add two valves per cylinder rather than four, water cooling in place of air cooling, and fuel injection as an alternative to carbs. In the 916, this same motor produces a violent brain-frazzling assault of power. Here, well, it couldn't be more different. It's smooth and civilised from 3,000 right through to 8,000 RPM. Yet, it's immensely satisfying, because what Ducati haven't done is to smother or stifle it. Its character comes bursting through every time you thumb the starter. Here is a motorcycle that looks, sounds and feels like the motor was made by Ducati, not Zanussi. Did you ever buy a record because you fancied the lead singer and then played it once? Of course you did. But the ST2 is that rare mix of good looks and pure talent. But some say that it stole its clothes and its best ideas from a classic original.